Hello, good afternoon. I'm very happy for you are joining us tonight because we have very interesting guests. And this is the very first talk within the Photograph Festival. We opened yesterday at the National Gallery. And I'm Mariana Siranova, and I'm responsible for the program at Transit Display here, because there is a series of lectures this week, and tomorrow there is an opening with two artists, who are three artists, actually four artists, but one is missing, who are here to talk about their work. Let me start with Asunción Molinos Gordo, who is now with us researching here in Prague into agrarian communities, together with Tomáš Uhnák, who is a Czech-based artist. And I'm very happy to welcome Tamás Kasáš, who is an artist from Budapest, who came to see us today, who is also presenting his work within the Common Harvest project that is going to be open tomorrow as well. So please come and see their work. I think we will start with the artist's presentation, so then I'm very happy to introduce you Asunción again, who is an artist who is focused on agrarian topics since long. She's been working with topics of the position of the peasants in nowadays world within the monopolized structures, and she's presenting a nice series at the show called The Peasant Has a Hole. And she also presented her work within Sharia Biennial in 2015. And she also works in the frame of topics such as narrative of the agricultural institutions and so on. But I would like probably to... And this is actually, we are going to start with one of your pieces, which is actually a cover of our new issue of Photograph magazine. We finally presented yesterday as well. There is also a few pages devoted to her work. So we can start with you, and then we can
go with. So I thought of starting today's talk with this photograph as a way of introducing what I do, and at the same time some of the topics that we are going to talk today in the roundtable. So what you see in the background is a photograph I took in my father's warehouse. He's a farmer, my brothers and parents are farmers, my grandparents and everybody back in the past, they all were. They have an exploitation of about 130 hectares. They do grain, cereal, and then, mainly grain, cereal, and grapes. So I took this photograph after they sell their harvest. So once the warehouse is full and then the traders come and collect all of the grain, what's left at my father's warehouse is pretty much this. This amount of dust and a bit of everything that you see. I don't know if you can really tell, but you have like some grain here. And then, you know, feathers and like the cats poo and walk around. And then you have a bit of cigarette bags from my dad and my brothers who smoke around. And in a way, I thought this was a great metaphor for what's left in my family after they sell the harvest. So once they sell the harvest and with the money they get in return, pay the credits for the loans they borrow, the petrol, the machinery, the seeds, the fertilizers, because I have to say, despite the fact that they are a family-run family, they still operate under the industrial and mechanic form of farming. So what's left in our house is very, very, very small, almost compared to this amount of dust. So in one way, I mean, knowing how my family were operating and stuff, and seeing many of my neighbors kind of going to the same direction, I started having these kind of like questions about what is the future of us, the farming communities. So for a long time, I've been looking into this, into the rural context. I've been, as Mariana was saying, you know, issues related to by technology and like bureaucracy in the territory and so on. But the project I'm going to present today is the one I'm showing here in transit that I did in Jordan. So in one way, these concerns that I had back home, I found that they could totally resonate with other countries I've been living in, like Egypt, like Oman, like Jordan, like Turkey. So when the work I'm going to present is called El Falah and the Fast. This means in Arabic, the peasant has a hoe. And it came out of this residency I did at Darat al-Funun in Amman, in Jordan. And when I, well, this is what it is, and then tomorrow you'll be able to see it in the show. It's a calligraphy exercise in Arabic. So when I started learning the Arabic language, I went to this very traditional school, and you do the very same, I can show you, the very same exercise, this is my terrible handwriting. the very same exercise that you do as a kid. So basically the professor will write a sentence for you, you know, and then you'll have to copy this sentence like a number of times, like this. So the professor will write the sentence in red, and then the student will have to write the same sentence several times as a form of gymnastic, you know, as a way of exercising your hand into a foreign calligraphy. So when I went to this school, suddenly I realized that in all of these sentences that you write for exercise, the farmer used to come very often. So, okay, you have, of course, the traditional sentence like, the cat drinks water, you know, or like, my mother is beautiful. And then you will have you know, the typical sentence of, the farmer has a hoe, you know, or the farmer goes on a horse, or the farmer eats roast pigeon. So suddenly it's like, wow, all of this is like extremely idealistic. There's no way like this can be compared to what's happening today. So I decided to open up a research and see what was the situation of Jordanian and Egyptian farmers and see if they were actually able to eat roast pigeon and goes on horses. So at the end, after being there for like quite some time, I managed to write a story of what I thought the situation was and what kind of like formulas or what kind of tendencies like small and medium farmers are falling into, until I wrote this story that sadly I'm going to read to you, so I apologize because it's a bit tedious, but I will do it very fast. it doesn't matter, don't worry. So this is the way it goes. Unit 1, Lesson 1, The Peasant. The peasant has a hoe, the peasant rides a horse, the peasant eats roast pigeon. The peasant harvests the wheat, the peasant waters the tomatoes, the peasant feeds the chicken. The peasant married off his daughter, the peasant builds a house, the peasant rests in the shade. Irrigation water gets privatized. Irrigation water gets channeled to supply the city. The fertile soil starts to turn into desert. The peasant pays for irrigation water. The peasant pays for industrialized fertilizers. The peasant pays for seeds. Livestock feed gets more expensive. Meat prices drop. The peasant sells all of his cattle. The peasant goes on a strike. The peasant demonstrates against the rise of the production cost. Military police repress the protest. The peasant gets advice from the agricultural engineer. The peasant receives a financial guidance from an international donor. The peasant gets a generous loan. The peasant mortgages his land. Public support for production gets dismantled and the market opens to import. Imported crops are sold below production cost. The peasant undersells his crops in the central market. The peasant does not want his children to become farmers. The peasant wants his children to study in university. The peasant's children and his wife move to the city. The peasant sells his land. The peasant looks for a job. The peasant is employed by a potassium private company. The peasant gets paid by day. The peasant has no contract. The peasant joins the army. The peasant dresses in uniform. The peasant stands guard at the barracks. The peasant receives orders. The peasant is involved in a special operation to appease the protest. The demonstrators protest against the rise of production costs. The peasant confronts the protesters. The peasants yell to another peasant. The peasant pushes to another peasant. The peasant shoots at another peasant. The high commanders send the peasant to fight in Haiti, Senegal, Afghanistan, South Sudan, Iraq, Eritrea, Libya, Kuwait, and Bahrain. They are sent to be in a peace mission to quell the protest. Peasants have begun to protest. You can hear them singing. Aish Horeya, Ekdala Ektimaya, meaning bread, freedom, social justice. This is the end of the fairy tale. And this is the end of the beginning of something else, which is the Arab Spring. As many of you know, this was one of the main calls at the very beginning of the streets in Tunis and Egypt and later Jordan and then Syria, and then you know, spread throughout all over the place. So this was a way also to link what's happening outside in the rural world that it seems invisible and what's happening in our cities. It's a direct relation. I mean, you cannot really overlook at what's happening outside, because the reason why we have the cities in this kind of like struggle is because of the dismantling of the rural society. So, in one way, I don't... sorry, this picture... in one way, I didn't want to show any more works. I wanted to focus only on this one because I think it opened up different issues that later we can share here in the table with some of my colleagues. So in one way, I would like to give the word to Tomás.
Yes, I just want to mention again, because as we started with you, that Tamás has been exhibiting in several places. And I think one of his most published and influential projects was on famine food, which was exhibited at Istanbul Biennial in 2012.
Actually, not there. But last time it was in for example, in Poland, in Muzeum Sztuki, and also in Bratislava some years ago.
Yeah. Well, at the show we'll open tomorrow, we're exhibiting a very new piece. Escapists are horticulture, right?
Yes.
Sorry. Yeah. So just go ahead. I just wanted to add some data. Thank you.
So I will show basically one project now, what called Famine Food. Usually I make a quite complex projects with many details and many layers. The Famine Food is made by the ex-artist collective, which is me and Donico Laurent. I mean, our collaboration since 10 years. And maybe it makes sense to explain the name here. In this discussion, we choose this name, ex-artist, because this is for us some kind of aim to reach. So we want to become an ex-artist at the end of our career, because there was a point some years ago, around 2010-11, when we had a quite difficult economic situation personally, and I myself was also thinking a lot what we should do, if I should go to an 8-hour job or to continue art, and so on. And finally, this ex-artist collective came out from this kind of crisis, let's say, which means that our aim now to have a land, to buy land, hopefully in the close future, and slowly turn our focus more on the on producing on the land vegetables and fruits instead of taking part in the art business. But because at the moment we don't have enough money to for this change, we have to collect money from art. And while, which is quite a naive idea, but it's kind of going on. But the point is not so much the money, but also the knowledge and the material. So we started to make projects, mostly by what we also make research on that kind of knowledge, which is useful in our normal life, I mean, out of the art field. And also in the art practice, we often use materials and tools, or what we can buy from the budget of the projects or the exhibitions, and later we can use it at home in the garden. So somehow we try to make some kind of permaculture system in our art practice. So that's the motivation. And one of the first project which was already based on this concept was the famine food. So first we started to learn about famine foods. So famine food are all those kind of food which were eaten in crisis or during war, and often these kind of foods get a bad connotation, and later they are not so popular anymore. So we collected many of these first on from the internet and from books. We made the research on famines, and mostly focusing in our region here in East Europe or Central Europe. And later we tried many of these foods. A part of these are like the extreme thing, like we made bread from wood dust, for example, but we didn't eat, but it's an object in this installation. But we also tried many things what we collected in nature and what became part of our life. So still we have the habit since we made this project, or we still develop this project, but since then there were many things like we collect nettle and we eat it. What everyone knows that it's edible, but no one really eat it today. And many other things. And in the project we also documented these things, how we try to deal with this knowledge, so how we try to turn this knowledge into practice. And also we made a lot of more poetic things like drawings and little slogans and poems on this topic. And this is which was exhibited, as you can see on this documentary video. This was in transit in Bratislava 2 years ago, I think. And so the point is that while we make all this our experiences visible, it doesn't mean that we really want to make an archive or we want to educate people on this topic. It's more for inspiration, and it's very important that it has an aesthetic layer with the drawings and the photos. So it's not just about the direct knowledge. Maybe it makes sense to say a few words about the installation itself, which is here on the exhibition place. It's a model in real size, and its function here is just to show our materials on the topic. But it was designed to build up in nature, where gatherers can use it as a center to collect the goods from nature into this pavilion and to utilize it and store it. And so it's easy to build up even if there is no flat land, because it just has a small part on the ground, and the roof is made for drying fruits under a plastic sheet, and as the hot air goes toward to the peak, there in darkness people can dry herbs, which has to be dried in without sunshine. So that's just about this little building. And just a few photo about collected goods. And in this topic, it's not only about the edible things from nature, but it's also about it's touching biodiversity in the food topic. As everyone knows today, we everywhere eat the same few cereals, and the local varieties and local food is disappearing. And famine food is quite connected to this topic, because there are many food which is just culturally determined and can be famine food in one culture, but a luxury food in another culture, like the lobster, for example. And there are many food, I don't know this name in English, but this is an earlier version. Before we had this pavilion, we exhibited this project this way. So there is this thing which is quite similar to potato, and it has a flower very similar to the sunflower. I don't know if everyone knows which is the plant. In Hungary it's cicsóka. I don't know if it's similar in Czech, maybe. Because in Hungarian many agriculture words come from Slavic languages, so sometimes it's fit. This is something which was eaten during war a lot, but since then not so much. But with this the fashion of bio food, it came back because it's very healthy. But it's not very economic to to sell it in supermarkets and to clean it industrially, because it has a very difficult shape usually and not so big, so it's a lot of work to work with it. But today it's very expensive relatively expensive on the market, I mean on the vegetable market. But same time, this is something which is extremely easy to produce, because once you put it into your soil, you cannot erase it anymore. It's just growing by itself. You don't have to do anything with it. You can just collect it at the autumn, and it's edible. And for example, this is one food what now we have in our garden. Usually we don't eat it, but we know it's always there. So once we have no money, we know that from where we can take it. And until then, it's just nice flowers. And maybe just a little few slides from the project, which will be exhibited tomorrow here. This is a narrative story, a kind of a neo-romantic situation when someone decides to leave the urban environment and move out to the countryside and face with its difficulties. So this story tomorrow will be visible in one of the rooms in its full length. I just wanted to show a little bit about from it. So maybe that's it by advance, and I guess in the discussion more things will come up.
Thank you very much. And I think then we can probably start to talk about, because we are talking about your projects, but maybe it's more important now to talk about the general motivation behind your projects, because this discussion is supposed to be used for more global topics. And the person who is behind the name of this discussion is Tomáš Uhnák, who is a researcher into community-supported agriculture and who also researches into unfair trading practices. So, and he publishes articles. He is also exhibiting tomorrow, and I think I would love you to probably stick on some topics that were already mentioned through Asuncion's and Tamáš's presentations. So, if you're happy with that,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for the presentation. Thank you so much for coming. I would like to focus on one very specific aspect that you both deal with somehow, and that's the farmer as a mythological creature, which both of you are somehow trying to cope with and presented it. I think one of the areas that defines our predicament and our era today is a great detachment from the food production and from the soil. If we take a look back into the history, the general society, or most of the society, was engaged in agriculture. And we all, our ancestors, were actually shaping the world, were shaping the landscape, and also vice versa, our bodies or the social body was shaped by us all. Since, let's say, 60s, and with the ideology of industrialization, a huge shift came into agriculture, huge detachment from the who actually produces food and what are the distribution chains. So, Asun, specifically in your research, you focus a lot about the different aspects of well-being of farmers and their social recognition. And you are very much interested also in the research that you're doing currently in Czech Republic. You are focusing on the farmers. In the first phase, you focused on the ecological farmers, mm-hmm. and how they perceive themselves in society, and what do they think about themselves and what role they play. So can you a little bit draw let's bring the global aspects into, let's localize them a little bit so that we can speak directly about the country where we live, most of us at least. And what are your conclusions so far? And what's your position in it as artist?
I mean, one of the things that we were asking in our interviews here in Czech Republic, because we had the concern about whether we artists are useful or not, and in which way can we contribute? Artists or image makers, doesn't matter whether you're a visual artist or you're a filmmaker or something else. Because as we thought, like there's this lack of visibility, as we said, about the farming communities and the peasants and the small producers. So the first question we raised to the farmers is like, okay, in which way can we be useful? Or, I mean, there is any images, or how are the images out there that do you feel recognized in these images that are being produced of you? And many of them kind of like give us some courage, you know? You remember you said, yes. Kind of like, they need to be this more accurate representation of what is happening to us, because at the end, yes, we do live as this kind of folkloric or mythological figure. I mean, in the case of Jordan, of this work, when this work was presented at an exhibition, we had this group of kids coming from the school. And one of the kids, when they were all reading the text, you know, as in a kind of exercise, they read that the wife of the farmer and stuff, and the kids said, wow, the farmer has a wife. You know what I mean? As they're totally depossessed, they don't even, I mean, it's like someone who is constantly represented to be on their knees, or like kind of like always on this working position, but that's about it, you know what I mean? Whether then this person goes to a house, or whether he has a family, or whether he has something else, this is like totally disconnected. So one of the kind of like concerns we had was if this kind of like chunk of society disintegrates and disappears, how many more things are gonna go with them? All of these things that are invisible, you know, all of the culture that they hold, but not only practical kind of like knowledge on how to grow a tomato, but more like on like the way they even socialize with their neighbors. You know what I mean? The way that you look after like on other people's kids that are not necessarily yours. So I mean, then when visiting here in Czech Republic, you know, these other farms, and asking, I mean, where they were, the way not the way they would like to be portrayed, but I mean, more of the things than they, what are the essentials? How do you define a farmer? They were just saying, okay, what you need to show is someone who has full dedication and who likes to live in the same spot all of their life. You know, you cannot be a nomad and be a farmer kind of at the same time. You need to have like this kind of
question,
no?
Yeah.
Right?
For me, it's a question. Exactly. Actually, in this story as well, if it would be possible to make a nomad garden.
So is it possible to be an artist?
I don't know,
farmer?
I'm just wondering about it, that maybe there is some trick by how it could be, but sorry.
No.
No, it's, I mean, I just wanted this little notes that maybe it would be some way to make some nomadic life when you bring your seeds and in every year to harvest in the same place and then you continue wandering or something, maybe. But it's true that today the traditional farmer's image is for sure connected to one place only.
Yeah, but maybe this brings us to the issue of like access to land, because if you want to be a nomad farmer, you have to be able to go and grow somewhere else. So I mean, how is the access to land? This is one of the things that we were commenting again on these interviews we conducted here in Czech Republic. Many of them actually started their farming projects after the Velvet Revolution. When they finally, you know, the farms were set free from the state, they were not state-owned anymore, and everybody could go back to their family farms, and with all of the enthusiasm in the world, they went back, it's like, okay, I want to be here for the rest of my life because I've been deprived from being here. So they didn't really want to move, they wanted to stay, take what it was theirs, or I mean, I don't know, this probably is something can be questioned also, and then just be there and start from their own roots. So it's like this whole thing about the access to land, no, whether it's yours or whether it's somebody else.
But maybe this is why you have to be nomad, because you don't have your own land, you just occupy lands after each other, because today there are a lot of abandoned places, mostly around mountains. Mm-hmm. In France at least, I have seen many places which are, you can see that there were farmers there, or mostly animal keepers, and but they left, and you could just occupy and start to work, and no one would see you and bother you, maybe. That's a question.
I'd like to make a follow-up on what you just explained, to put it a little bit into context, that for the purpose of context, we have to imagine what the future will look like, what the future will be, and the predictions are that in upcoming 10 years, 3.5 million European farmers will disappear because most of them are in the age of 50 and they have no one to pass the farms to. So 3.5 million farmers disappear, plus according to FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency of United States, predicted that between 2020 and 2030 there will be huge social unrest in the West, especially in the West, due to over 385% price spikes, and the military is already preparing for a response. So, especially United States and Britain. And Tamás, you are somehow occupied also with the idea of the ultimate end somehow, that I'm just curious to learn whether all of these projects that you are concerned with and engaged in lead to some, are you looking for sustainability in certain aspect? I would like to open up the issue of sustainability. What does it mean for you as a farmer or an artist? Yeah,
I wouldn't call myself as a farmer, definitely, because I have no land and just a very small garden, but we even just rent. And I'm more interested in horticulture than in big farming. But anyway, it's the point is, for me, this collapsing scam scenario, an economic or ecological collapse, what might happen. It's at the beginning, I just used it as a working tool for my projects, because it's always very easy to imagine if there is a big collapse, after you can imagine anything. So anything can happen. And it was more an artistic tool. It was not so much interest in how the collapse will happen, what will be after. So it was not so much that, just a using of the situation. And later, I think around this famine food project is a bit changed. And the kind of a preparation became interesting, but somehow even we went through on this, because today it's there is this preparer movements and such things, and also in the mass culture, mainstream culture, there are a lot of films and literature on this topic already, what will happen and hope people will survive. But for me, it's more interesting, not in one hand that if you are prepared, you might be more autonomous in the present. We even had a slogan in the Famine Food Project on this. So if you are prepared, you are for the future collapse, you are more autonomous already in the present. And the other thing is that it is not only about surviving or how you survive, but also how to have a good life. Even if you live in some kind of poverty or simplicity, let's say, and that's much more what is interesting for me. So not just to survive somehow and to be able to be self-sustainable on some level, but also to have fun with all these things, and somehow that's the point. And I think I don't believe in that someone or a small community could become totally self-sustainable today, because, for example, you never can make a medical operation and this kind of difficult things. But you can learn how to have food and how to home, maybe, I think, or settle. These things are available for people, I think, if they learn. And if you have these and you live more in a natural environment, I think it's quite easy to have fun. For example, in this famine food project when we were looking for these edible things in the forest and so on. It's not just, it has a quality of life. It's not just about that we have to eat something and not to die in hunger, but also to enjoy, to be in the nature and to collaborate with the nature. And it's the same with the gardening, I think. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I answered.
You mentioned the aspect of a good life. Asun, with the research that you're doing, one of the things that pop up through the interviews was that, and again, I'm stressing out that the research is being done with ecological farmers or organic farmers. It's very interesting that on one hand, all of them expressed that they don't have access to the market, that they're unable to sell their produce, and if they are, it's very problematic. But on the other hand, they were actually, all of them, talking about sort of good life and different aspects of it. What does it mean for them? And they're actually, for them, it's more important to have this so-called good life than access to the market. And the ways how they're able to survive is also, among other things, that they are becoming part of independent distribution structures, like the community-supported agriculture, different types of cooperatives, and so on. Can you a little bit draw a line between these organic farmers and their perception of their role and their understanding of good life, whatever that means, and your previous researches with the GMO farmers and the industrial farmers?
Yeah, I mean, the first surprise was that, you know, that in my, in one way I thought that the ones who were only struggling were the ones who had the industrial mode of production. And then, yeah, so it seemed like the agriculture, I mean, the ones who are producing ecological food are also struggling. The first thing they mentioned as a positive thing was the autonomy with time. You know, that they were totally in control, they didn't have to rush with the market prices, they didn't have to sell whenever the market asked them to sell, because they have these other supported structures. But actually, probably you could tell them better about what is a community-supported agriculture, because, I mean, as a form of a strategy, many of you probably, I mean, already know.
Can I just ask how many of you heard of community-supported agriculture? In Czech, we translate it as a KPZ, Komunito podporované zemědělství.
Everybody, yeah.
No, not actually. Half, let's say half. Okay, so I think maybe we could explain a little bit that, because as I mentioned, on one hand, we are losing farmers and we are losing diversity of what we eat, mainly thanks to the distribution chains. We can imagine the whole system as the sand clocks, you know? You know what I mean? What's it called in English? And so we have thousands and thousands of producers, we have millions of consumers, but among these two areas, there's a net which is controlled by, let's say, 10 distribution chains. I'm talking about supermarket chains. And especially in Czech Republic, 87% of all foods which is being sold is through supermarket chains. So they pretty much control what we have access to. And for farmers, if they're not part of the supermarket chains, it's like if they don't exist because they don't have access to the consumers. So that's why since 60s, 70s, alternative chains are being created under the name, for example, community-supported agriculture, which is basically looking for direct contact with the farmers. We are creating communities of consumers which are directly linked to the farmers themselves, and we're sourcing the food directly from them. And we commit for the... we actually take some of the risks of the farming on ourselves by, for example, providing finances which we don't reclaim back if in the case of a disaster, for example, if the farmer has bad harvest, for example. And in other words, The new distribution systems are looking for short links, short distribution systems where there is no mediator among them. So this is like, and also I have to mention the biggest movement today, La Via Campesina, I call it the peasant, feminist, anti-capitalist movement, with over 200 million peasants, small-scale farmers, is, I believe, the emancipatory movement of today. And my question to both of you is, how do you perceive your practice as artists in this concept, context of the global movements and the food movements? And because most of your work is research-based, if I may say so, with some future visions to, for example, you would like to start farming practice, and you're using, maybe, I'm not sure if this is fair to say, you're using the art practice as a means or tool to become a farmer. which is a very beautiful concept, of course. And for you, Asun, can you also explain, like, what's your, where are you heading, actually, as an artist in this context?
Okay. So I have to confess, I am totally stuck. No, basically, in one way, I have this intention of, like, using art as a platform for visibility and try to, since art is so urban-oriented and many of the concerns, so at least in Spain, when I start doing this kind of work, the art scene was totally taken for the gay struggle. So the gay community used art very efficiently in order to get many of the rights back, and they did very well. And in terms of socially appreciation and people being less, less nasty with the gay community, they really succeeded. So in one way, I was like, yeah, you know, we can use it. We can use art in order to change the perception that people have about other social classes. But I don't know why it's not kind of working with. or maybe I don't know. So yeah, it's not so sexy. Yes, it's not. I mean, tomatoes cannot be compared really, or like I don't know, farmers. So. So I don't know. I mean, I'm at this point where I really don't know what to do. I don't know. I mean, I'm just waiting for some like drag queen to come and save us, because really, I mean, I don't know. So I don't know. I mean, I think yes. I mean, until certain extent, yes, the word is going out there, and there's like this general concern about what is happening in food production. But in one way, the concern is very specific. The people are caring because they care about health. So why there is this concern is because I don't want to eat this because I will develop cancer. I don't want to eat that. But at the end of the day, we only see kind of the very useful kind of layer of it, but we don't get to see what other things they are bringing. I mean, imagine a place, I mean, imagine a future where 83% of the territory of a nation is empty. I mean, imagine like a country like Spain, like where most of the people are now being centered in like Madrid, Barcelona, a few cities. What are we going to do with the rest of the territory? It's already changing. I mean, I come from a very small place. Its name is Guzman. Every time I can like make publicity, Guzman power. So we are only 80 people living there, and we are dying like all of our neighbors. The population is becoming very old very rapidly, and. And the thing is, the situation is already changing because there's a lot of kind of unrest. I mean, like the security in our villages is already changing because we are very little. So everybody, I mean, it's very easy for thieves to come and take the things from the houses, from the farms. I mean, even just junk. So the way that the life is developing is becoming not only less rich and like poorer and older because there's not that much energy. And if you see like a farmer's demonstration in Madrid, I mean, it's like pretty much it's everybody above the 60s, and they do it purely because they are very nice people and they want to support the few farmers, young, but there's like, I don't know the percentage, but very, very few small young farmers. So at the end, you know, like this, I mean, one way I would like to, through art, or maybe, see, if I find a different way of doing it, I will do it in this other way. Try to share with other people, you know, how many other complex issues fall under farming that is not only food production, that it has to do with keeping, you know, like a large part of our territory in use and not only productive but alive, and not purely for the enjoyment or the leisure kind of thing of the people from the cities who need to take a break every now and then, but like respected as its own entity. You know, I wish at some point the rural could have this very strong pulse to shape the world the other way around, not always be on the demand of, you know, this group of people who are having the drive on, you know, the driving the world, they are demanding this from us, therefore we have to change our practices in order to fulfill their demand. I wonder how can we make our demands to be heard and to be on top of the list. So I don't know if you know, anybody of you.
I don't know, somehow I also don't believe in the effectiveness of art, contemporary art today as a propaganda tool. I see rather, and also I think the many of the exhibition places as alienated as supermarkets. I see more my art practice as something like a laboratory work, and White Cube also as a laboratory space where anything can happen, so kind of a safe place where you can try things and for what you can do things, and maybe you can affect few people, so maybe it's not so effective, but that's probably the point, that we don't have to go like industrial agriculture to produce a lot and economically, but maybe just to go slow and in small scale, and for this art is I think kind of a good space and hidden enough to figure out little secret things, probably.
I believe that one of the aspects for change or even emancipation could be formulating the needs of the farmers and the consumers, and trying to find a link between these two needs and how we can actually share them, or how we can help each other in a way. To what extent do you find your practice useful in creating these connections or links between farmers and general public, if so? And by public, I mean, of course, consumers.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't have the answer.
I also don't know. And so that's what I said. I think it's not that effective. But I think through some part of participatory projects, it's maybe possible, but I especially don't deal with such things, and also as an artist I don't imagine myself as a mediator between these two groups, but it's more that I myself want to become not a farmer in that meaning that who makes food for others, but who just produce food for himself or herself, or for a small scale, like a family or a small community, and if many people can do this, they can exchange their products. So I don't, I'm not thinking in big scale. Like I don't live in Budapest since quite many years now, but just close to Budapest in a smaller village. And since we lived there, we started to make some vegetables. Slowly, we learned how to have rabbits and chickens, and now we are waiting for the first eggs. And I guess when we will have the eggs, we don't have to buy the honey anymore from a local producer, but we can exchange maybe, or this kind of thing. So I'm more, I would inspire others also to start to produce, because what is interesting is not only the big farmers are disappearing, but on the countryside, before it was absolutely normal to have some vegetables just next to the house in the direct garden, and today in villages what you can see is mostly just the nice grass, and there are no local or no food around the house, which would have been quite I think there will be a big lack of this when the crisis became more serious, because before, for example, during the socialist time, sometimes this kolkhoz system didn't work well, and there was not enough food, but always had food around the house for the people. And this is something which is also disappearing today, and I'm more looking for these small scale things than big solutions.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting what you mentioned about cooperatives, because we are talking now about the new movement which aims to create new cooperatives. While we who are from socialist countries, we had different experience probably. So when you sometimes confront your work and your background with other speakers, like we have Asuncion, who is coming from Spain, so we have, I don't know, quite different views maybe, or in terms of history, we have different experiences. Have you noticed some special situation in terms of this, because it's really different to come from a social country?
I think in Hungary, of course, at the very, very beginning, because this kolkhoz system was a forcing cooperative, and many people who had a land in the cooperative and tools, they didn't want to work efficiently for them, but they were more working at home after the job time, and this is from where it was an importance of the foods around the house, and even the system later let this going on and even supported in a way. But I think in Hungary later this kolkhoz system was working kind of well in the meaning of the production, so they could produce cereals and such mass food quite well at the end. But still, after the change, many people has, of course, the bad association with the kolkhoz system and the cooperatives, and I just so today, I mean today, like some years ago, I heard a story when one farmer wanted to make a cooperative with the people because of the food chain story, because alone he couldn't sell his paprika for the supermarkets, but he thought that if the people in the area go into a cooperative, they will be able to do this. But most of his neighbors didn't want to take part in this because of these bad memories on it.
But these cooperatives were kind of the only official form how to operate the centralized agriculture during the socialist regime. So this is the way it got discredited, and it lost its credit. So it's probably still kind of in mind. Yeah. While the new co-ops you are kind of promoting, and you are researching into this area, something quite different. We should really distinguish we can understand a cooperative in very different ways, depending on the context of each country, each.
It's very interesting that you brought it up, because exactly like you explained, I think we share the same part of history and situation also, and the attitude of general public towards systems such as cooperatives has this negative connotation connected with the past as regime. But on the other hand, it's very interesting to see that especially small-scale farmers are becoming voluntarily part of these new systems, because it's actually probably one of the only ways which they can survive. And I think the biggest movement in Europe is in France, where according to the National Bureau for Research on Public Health, they issued a study in which they claim that every other day one farmer commits suicide. So every 2 days a lot of suicide farmers, same in Britain. And the way they were able to shift the narrative of farming and their attitude towards what is farming, what is food, and what are the consumers, is connection, direct connection with the consumers. And I actually wanted to open up last big area, which is commons.
Yeah.
Commons, and because I think the fight that we are leading now is for reclaiming of the commons and trying to formulate and understand what is actually public, what shouldn't be privatized, and so on. And also, you specifically did research on the seeds and seed law in Turkey. Can you a little bit explain about, because I think seeds and land together with, like, just to put up into context, what are we talking when we talk about commons, that we're talking about public goods like water, access to pure water, oxygen, of course, land, what else? Seeds. And seeds as a, to big extent, unrecognized cultural heritage, which the small-scale farmers are trying to protect and share among themselves, because with the GMO seeds which are being introduced, with the hybrid seeds which are being introduced, we are losing a huge part of biodiversity. So what do you think this means for us, for the society, the loss of biodiversity and the loss of seeds?
I mean, what we could think is the bigger picture of the commons, in the sense, like, there is this very easy way of understanding what's happening today. There is this term by David Harvey, who said accumulation by depossession, probably most of you know. So what this involves is, like, the disappearing of the commons is what's making this very strong, like, pockets of wealth all over the world. So the thing is, like, there are many things that we are not kind of generally aware of, the value that that they have, and then they really are commons, and they're little by little being, like, confiscated by this phenomenon of privatization. One of them are the seeds. Until very recently, basically, I don't know how much of you know, probably for many of you, you already know everything about seeds. Some of you will be still new on this. So in one way, just for you to understand that the seeds that we have today are not the ones of prehistorical times. They have been altered by the labor of millions and millions of farmers over the period of years, and is the intellectual capital of the peasantry worldwide. So these seeds have been improved through traditional techniques, in which I can give you a couple of examples. But lately, since those who were involved in chemistry started to come into the agricultural sector, started to develop also their seeds by using all of these laboratory techniques. At the same time as they are doing this, they are appropriating the commons. They are appropriating the. I would like to know how many of you know about these things and how they are familiar. Because how many of you know about the intellectual property on seeds?
That's
okay.
So basically, the seeds have been common property. They don't belong to anybody in particular, they belong to everybody. And the reason why we have so many, or we used to have so many, is because the farmers have been able to exchange seeds freely without any kind of restriction. And this has been, like, the reason why, after all of this massive exchange that has been going through all over the globe, we have managed to grow. Like, for instance, in India, they have 200,000 types of rice. I don't know if this can go into anybody's head, because in my head, I'm still struggling to understand what it means. 200,000 kinds of rice. I mean, Ida, you know, what does it mean? and how does this happen, you know? I mean, and some of these varieties are able to grow under very saline soil, and this is one of the problems we have today. And others are able to grow up to 5.5 meters high if there is a flood. And none of this thing has been done through any kind of, like, laboratory or any kind of, like, modification. This has been done exclusively through the knowledge of generations of farmers who have known how to juxtapose seeds, how to change the different atmosphere in which seeds have been growing, and how to make them this way. So all of this heritage, basically at this, we are in a crucial point in the last, I don't know, maybe 30 years,
in which like these new companies who are trading with seeds, they are kind of capitalizing these seeds and reclaiming the property rights on them. So if you are a farmer and you're gonna grow a specific kind of rice, you will have to pay a royalty to the seed producer. The same way that you pay a, I don't know, a royalty to the Rolling Stones every time you play it in your nightclub, if this is the case, I have no idea. So you as a farmer will be called to pay a royalty for using this seed, and you will not be able to keep the seed for yourself to generate it, I mean, to seed it the next year. So, I mean, this is like a massive topic that is bringing a lot of consequences. The first one is bringing an economical chain, one more economical chain on the economy of the small producers, because it's not only that you have to pay all of these kind of production costs, but on top of everything, you need to pay the royalties for the laboratory. But at the same time, they're taking this from you, because you, as a farmer, you are the legitimate owner on this, because this is the intellectual kind of outcome of generations of your you know, fellow workers. So this is one of the things, that one of the very clear examples when we talk about the commons and how the commons are, I mean, the disappearance of the commons is the, I mean, really the reason behind, you know, we have all of these pocket of crazy amount of wealth in different locations, but this has many other consequences. In one way, I really want you to talk, just because I'm so curious what's happening in your head now. After 1 hour of us, like, I mean, I don't know. Would you like to open the word to see, Echo, what's happening, no? Shall we?
Yeah. So, what's going on in your head?
Well, I was thinking about the farmers' movement in Spain, because I've heard from young Spaniards also around Catalonia, with the real estate crisis, I keep so many people losing their homes. Many of the young generation went out into the countryside to the grandmother's house that, you know, is about to be empty, and then starting to farm again. And it's more than just a few. I think it's a real movement that happened. Is that also something that happened in Madrid, or is it not something you take into consideration with your research?
Yes, this is happening. I mean, some of my colleagues are back in the village, but I mean, they are having a survival economy. It's not that, you know what I mean? Like, if you can manage to live with 400 euros a month, you can say you're living from. But it's not like, you know what I mean? If you sell mobile phones in the city, you'll probably make twice or three times the money. So, I mean, it is a movement, but it's a movement that is purely coming out of a struggle. I mean, it doesn't mean that it cannot be the beginning of something. Yeah, it can be the beginning of something.
But at
the same time, one other thing that is happening now with the burst of the, you know, like the economical bubble in Spain in relation to real estate is like now all of the investors are investing in agriculture. So they are creating another bubble in agriculture that I don't know when is going to burst. So since 2008, all of the investors have shifted from soil, as in urban soil, into farming.
I think another very interesting example is Greece, in which Greece is a very interesting melting pot of different aspects of agriculture, especially because next month I'm going to do research in Greece about how society shifted from the cities to the countryside, exactly what you described. And what's very interesting that the part of society which is most vulnerable are the farmers, because new taxes were introduced towards especially small-scale farmers, and in order to stay alive and in order to sustain their practice, they have to become export oriented, and so they can't really produce for locals. And but on the other hand, it's very interesting that the rise of the CSA movement, which I explained earlier, is happening in Greece, but on completely parallel level. They have no idea that there's such a thing as a CSA movement. They have very pragmatic need to be self-sufficient, independent, and provide for their families and their communities, first of all with the food, second with the energy. And that's why they're a very interesting situation in which they occupy, for example, former military areas, and they turn them into agriculture fields where they grow food basically for themselves. So again, we were talking about this big collapse. There are many, many predictions of a collapse. It doesn't mean it has to happen. Of course, it's entirely up to us whether
it's already happening.
It's partially already happening, but at the moment we're creating like a pillow or like a airbag. Like for me, the CSA movement is an airbag for society in which if such a thing comes, I'm ready basically to move to my farmer and live there. And so we're basically creating already these that's not the primary goal, but there is always this option to go to the countryside where we have safe point, which is producing food, and that we can be self-sustainable to some extent. But again, in Greece, this is not the case. They're not thinking in futuristic terms. The crisis happened already, and it's a matter of life and death in many cases. So.
But I think there is an important keyword maybe mm-hmm. here, just to bring, mm-hmm. is the folk science. So all those knowledge, how to make a life by your own without the city around you, and this knowledge is the same way disappearing as mm-hmm. as the special local varieties of seeds, yes. and so on. So it's a big question how we can reinvent folk science and learn back and bring back things, which is for me quite interesting, and it's not some kind of neo-primitivist idea, but more. And here also art can come into the story, because art is always about some kind of creativity to solving problems mm-hmm. With creativeness, and I think folk science is quite close to this. When you yourself solve a problem and you don't call the technicians to make you something, and all this knowledge to have. And if you have such knowledge, you can do things by yourself, then it means that you can have a role in a community mm-hmm. where others also have this, and you can exchange. So maybe.
Well, both of you are very much aware of the issues that are being there. The question is, do you think, or perhaps you are already somehow engaged in it, but do you think your practice can lead, for example, to improving the methods of production as such?
Improving,
for example, the methods of agricultural methods. Because I'm just talking about this because there's this big dispute over, at the moment, there is some 7 billion people in the world. It will rise up to 9.5 billion in upcoming 20, 30 years. The question is how we're gonna feed the world. One claim, we have to intensify, we need more industrialized agriculture. Others say, also the United Nations a little bit shifted their position, they say, no, it's the small scale farmers, and that at the moment we are producing enough already. We are producing for 14 billion at the moment. It's just the problem of redistribution, that half of the food is being wasted and the second half is going to the West, basically. So the question is, so it's probably the ecological farming, which is in the
front. It's just the normal.
which is in the front of development of the agricultural practices without harming the environment. And I was just wondering whether you think your practice could be somehow translated into also different methods of production.
That I can absolutely imagine, and this is actually what I'm interested in. I mean, when I'm saying I want to become a farmer, it doesn't mean that I would totally give up that kind of activity, what I do now, I mean with art. But I absolutely can imagine in a permaculture farm. I think permaculture is already quite known today, so I don't have to explain, but the point is that you have a system where all the elements are connected and designed in certain ways on a farm. And that's something I think, at least I imagine, that with the same motivation, I would be happy to construct such systems and elements of such system and designing tools and things in a farm with the same way as I do installations today, which are not useful that much. So I can, the way of thinking can be used on that. Mm-hmm. If it can be improved so much that it's changed the world, that I don't know. It's again just about the small scale. But I think it's also a little bit similar to the seed problem, because there are today these seed banks in the north, in the ice. There are these things where they put all the seeds, and there are in Scandinavia. I was in Sweden on a workshop where I discussed with local researchers who collect seeds from local farmers and from different families, and they send them to the seed bank. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that seed banks cannot be as efficient as the people themselves. So the best seed bank is a farm.
Yeah.
Because if you have a seed or a plant, in every year you can select the nicest ones. And they always follow that climate and that soil where it is. So it's always that variety belongs to that place. But if you put a seed into the seed bank and you take it out in after 100 years or even 20 years, maybe the climate is not the same. There are different pests which are new,
yes.
Insects improved during this time and so on. So the seed is not so good anymore. So that's, I think folk science is also a bit similar to this, that if you do your practice in the same place always, it's also there is some kind of selection between your inventions and things are developing and growing.
You wanted to mention something?
Yeah, no, I mean, elaborating on the whole idea of folk science, I mean, I will reverse the question, and it's like farmers, in order to survive, they need to be artists. So, for instance, in the case of my family, my parents and my brothers, they come out with in very ingenious situations to, solutions to different situations. Like, for instance, they had a problem with a plow that it doesn't quite work. So they will take it, they will wield it, they will sculpt the machine until it does work the way they want it. And it happened this time that they solved a very big problem that one of the machine had, until the point that everybody in the area was talking about it. And then the maker came, they sent someone, hello, who are you? I want to talk to you. Can I visit your, tick, 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 started taking pictures, they collected all of the information, and thank you, bye-bye. And they improved the machine without mentioning my father, my brother, none of the work they did, the time and effort and the knowledge, the folk science they invested on the machine. And they didn't think like a thanking letter, you know, this is the way it works. So the thing is, because in the farming society, you are not used to ask for things in exchange. I mean, sometimes yes, but sometimes no. You know, you share your ideas, you share your seeds, you share things, because at the end somebody will share, you know, you share problems, so at the end you share solutions. But I mean, when, you know, this kind of satellite creature comes from the work or the world of like, you know, like the machine makers kind of industry takes the farmer and collects the data and just make it profitable somewhere else. Or like in another occasion, the European community is changing the legislation constantly, as you know, and for farmers as well. So there was this time they launched this law and many of these laws are like designed with the excuse of saving nature and because of the ecological system. That's why the farmers end up hating the ecologists. because everything that is changed in farming agriculture, the policymaker says no, it's because of the environment, without explaining any further. So the thing is, at this occasion, what happened is like the European Union launched this law that said all of your machinery, all of your tractors needs to have this apparatus that is called the beast scare, asusta bestias. I don't know how you can translate it. Beast threatener or beast, something to scare the beast. So the thing is, okay, yeah, scare what? A scarecrow, but not for birds, for like beasts in general, so it involves wolves, deer, I mean, anything. So the thing is, the farmers in the area were trying to find out what this apparatus was, which aim was to scare the beast, and they were asking each other, have you seen, where can I get one? And they went to the syndicates, they are asking the syndicates, where are these apparatus, how can we get them, because we don't want the police to come, and the police started already hunting the farmers, going into the fields in the middle of nowhere. Do you have this apparatus called the beast scare? No. So, and they like, okay, 3,000 euros, fine, boom, here, 3,000. And they start collecting taxes and money and everything. So my family decided, okay, nobody has seen one of these machines. We're gonna go to the workshop and we're gonna build one. So they create a sculpture, basically, with chains and things and lights and and they assemble it on top of the, in front of the tractor. So despite the fact, by the way, these people consider them beasts are idiots, because, I mean, how are you not going to be scared of a tractor already? I mean, it makes this noise, it's bigger like a mountain, and it has lights front, backward, and one that goes like this. So, I mean, it's already scary. You don't need to have the scary beast thing. So anyway, so they put together this sculpture in front of the tractor, and when the Guardia Civil, you know, the police from the region came, and was like, do you have this? Yes, we do have it. Come on, have a look. Oh, okay. And last, they didn't, you know, they didn't get the fine. So at the end, I mean, and of course later this law, after like 1 or 2 years, they make it disappear, because the purpose of the law is not to protect the beast from anything. It's just to have an excuse to collect money. As simple as that. So, I mean, when, again, how artists can help farmers? No. How farmers can help artists to be more creative? Because they are artists already who have the best strategies to survive. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for this. I would like to open up discussion for any one of you to ask a question or a remark to the discussion.
Let maybe ask you, like, if you are thinking, or there is the issue of the European Union supporting the farming, actually, like, giving some money to take care of the land, and I think it's become quite a major issue, like, because it used to be, like, a nice idea, like, taking care of the land, but now it's become, like, more business, like, for the big companies, like, to buy land, and here it's increasing, it's very increasing price for the land, and no small farmers can buy the land now, so it may become this artificial cooperatives now, not to be like together, but to have to be in a position to big farms to buy the land as well. Yeah, so like that's the issue, like if there is some movement or something like which take care about this, like,
yes.
Yeah. I mean, the history of subsidies is nasty from the very beginning, and everything starts with the Marshall Plan after the Second World War. So, I mean, at the beginning everything looks very crystal clear. It's like the way of having these general plans was not through subsidies, was through have a plan to improve the production in Europe and to be until the point that you're self-efficient and you cannot go back to, you know, the situation before the war. And then later, it was also a way of getting people into, you know, the Cold War kind of situation and seducing some countries into supporting certain kind of politics. And once everything was done, then they started to introduce the subsidies as a way of being able to exploit farmers worldwide. So what happened is, like, if you a regular farmer in Europe, with the money they get from their crops, they're only able to pay back the production cost most of the time. Or if there's something left, it's very little. So you live out of the subsidies. You pay your rent and your phone and your wedding and whatever from this money. You don't make the money from your crops. So most of the farmers are actually against this. They are saying, I don't want a subsidy. I just want to make money. I already work in like 16 hours a day during the 4 months of the summer plus the winter time. I don't want charity, you know. I want to make, I want to be able to make a living with the work I'm already doing. So there are movements, they are against, you know, the whole thing of the subsidies, but the thing is, the only way to appease the farmers is by compensating the production cost with this extra money. Because farmers worldwide are producing for much less because they are under a bigger struggle. So, I mean, the subsidies thing is not even from the beginning.
Just to add, and this is quite significant information, that 50% of the whole European budget is going towards agriculture and to subsidies. So imagine this huge budget, 50%, half of the EU budget, just to keep the system going, basically, because food, as Asun mentioned, plays an incredibly significant role in sustaining the well-being of society and sort of peace, keeping up the peace, sort of, and also the situation in Syria escalated mostly through agriculture and through lack of subsidies and financing of the agriculture systems, which were going towards the cash crops, industrialization, and so on. But to your question about the alternatives, I explained about the CSA movement, which is more towards already farmers who have access to land, but there's a very significant movement which is aiming at access to land. Many of them, I think the most important ones, the French, Belgian Terre de Lien, or German Die Agronauten, and thanks to these also we have one in Czech Republic, which was established this year. It's called Nadace pro půdu. Sorry? Nadace pro půdu was created as a model which is following these German, French, British alternatives. And that's basically, the idea is to create to create foundation or fund where you have either money or soil. So at the moment, several subjects, mostly ecological farmers, gave up sort of their land partially to this foundation, so that people, young people who would like to start farming, or farmers who are already farming and want to get a little bit bigger and don't have the money or the land, this foundation can grant them the land under specific circumstances. But the point is to retrieve land from the market, create different prices, which are not market-oriented, and they are providing them to the farmers, of course, under the circumstances that they have to work on it on ecological practices. So this is a very significant movement, and I think it's one of the most important as well, because the problem is that subsidies are distorting the viewpoint on the real price of food. We have absolutely no idea about the price of food that we are being sold or that we buy, because it's heavily subsidized and it's creating externalities, negative externalities, which are not calculated within the price. So at the end, if we buy food in supermarkets, which are discounts and so on, it's really nice that we have such a cheap food, but on the other hand, we pay with our health, with the ecological catastrophes and so on, which is paid by us again, but through other means.
It's the same with highways and power stations.
Yeah. So again, all of these movements, the access to land movement, the CSA movement, is also aiming at rethinking what is the price of food and what is our understanding of price making strategies.
And can I ask
you,
did you have a chance to meet some scenario what can be like the situation without any subsidies, like if it isn't from some point of view much better?
Well, that's the point of the CSA movement. Most of the farmers, it depends very much on the country.
Not as for the movement at this time, but at all, like the whole system of Yarovin now.
Well, if you take a look on the Czech Republic, the argumentation is that even if you're an ecological farmer, it's somehow, and we perceive this as a fair and as something which should be done, that state should reward those who want to protect the environment, basically. So it's not, they're not getting subsidies basically for their production, but for improving the land and improving the environment. So it's basically just a shift of thinking, a shift of understanding where the money goes. And now all over European Union, there are these programs which are aiming at small scale farmers and so on, because up until now, the subsidies, the bigger you are, the more you get, of course, because it's allocated towards the hectares, the amount of hectares. And Czech Republic is very specific in these terms, because within the European Union, we have the most fragmented ownership of the land, so we have the most owners of the land, but we have very little subjects who actually work on the land. So I think the average is that Germany is around, the average size of farm in Germany is around 12 to 20 hectares. In Czech Republic it's around 100 hectares average, more or less. So there's a huge disproportion between the ownership and the actual practice. And actually, I think the reason for this is the structure of farming in the past regime, that we got disconnected from the farming, and the generations who received the land after the Velvet Revolution, they didn't know what to do with it, basically. They didn't know how to farm.
It was a completely different situation without any grants, which
So they are actually happy to give it to subjects like Agrofert, you know, to Mr. Babiš, because he's got the resources, he has idea what to do on the land. So. But the problem is that people, by giving or renting, also very often the land, they don't have a say to what kind of methods can be used on their land. So at the end, they end up very sad, because they can only observe how their land is being destructed and can do nothing about it, basically. So yeah, that's the situation at least here.
So it's, we turned very into a very local introduction about what's going on here, which is great. Is there something else coming to your mind? Maybe we should go to Utopias, finally, which is actually the end of the title of this discussion. So. How would you change the world? You know, I want to live in a better world, so how can we manage or imagine at least?
I think we should start with imagining the future worlds, right? Like, I think it's already happening, to be honest. I think we're on a... There are so many options that we have.
You promise.
I promise we will change the world.
All right.
No, but I was a little bit afraid that this discussion will lead to yet another detachment from the farm world, because we didn't invite any farmer as such, which would definitely promote different viewpoint on the whole situation. We decided not to, but I think it's very interesting what you both mentioned, how we can play a role actually in the system, and how can we from the other way around influence the farming, which I find like a positive conclusion.
I mean, I don't know, I think my conclusion is like many of the big tools are proving their uselessness, like art and politics are one, they're proving they don't work. So I think, I mean, it's really up to each one of us to take a stand. I mean, I'm very happy to be able to stay here with you this 1 month, because knowing the CSA movement, you know, the community supported agriculture, I see it's a model that can totally work. The only thing that it needs a lot of like commitment from everybody who's involved. So, I mean, I don't think there are big miracles, it's only about taking it personal. Mm-hmm. Taking the challenge personal and seeing what you can do in your lifetime and which ones are the tools that you know what to use best. So if you're a writer, if you're a stripper, if you're whatever, you know, like a rubbish mm-hmm. collector, I mean, what is in your hand to do, and ally yourself with these other people who are like-minded. I think this is the only thing, at least you can see some change in the short term. Otherwise, if you're hoping for the next president of who knows which country to come, or whichever political group,
that's not going to happen.
But I think just for the last thing we were discussing about the land, who can access the land, and I was thinking a lot, where could I plant things before I had a garden already, and like on the edge of the big fields where the weeds are growing, or in forest or such thing, and it didn't grow out specially, but I'm still thinking about certain bushes and trees which give fruits to plant somewhere outside, so not in an owned place. Mm-hmm. But my mother, I influenced her, and she was faster than me. She started a little kind of a project in the city where he lives. It's called Dunajváros. It's about 60,000 people live there. So that was the first socialist town in Hungary. It was called Stalin town for a while. So it's really a city what they built up on agricultural fields for steelwork. And anyway, so some years ago my mother started the project. She as the local artist to design little tickets, and she sell these tickets, and she buy trees for that money, but she plant around the houses, so in the city, in different parks and so on, and all these trees are will give fruits like walnut mm-hmm. or peach and this mm-hmm. kind of thing, so edible trees in the city. So I think this kind of little things can be also an alternative. I mean, I don't say that this will really give a big change, but all these, so we don't have just to think about how we can change the big system, because we feel useless in this, but there are a lot of little paths that maybe we can find.
Thank you for this mentioning, because I just realized that since beginning of this year, is it? I think since the beginning of this year, we have a new platform in Czech Republic called Na Ovoce. Maybe many of you know this platform already, which is aiming at actually recognition of the existing fruits in the common space. Or this is actually one of the commons that we share, fruit trees and plantations which were established in 50s, 60s, or even earlier, which were abandoned for past, let's say, 20 years. And now they're aiming at recognition and revitalization. And they're, what I find very inspiration were they is the aspect of care, like redistribution of care or revitalization of the aspect of care for the commons and the public goods. And just last week they actually did a huge event in one of the Prague's Cerkne Sad. Yeah, orchard, a tree, apple orchard, and they cooperate with the city, with the several political parties and so on, in revitalization of these things which belong to all of us basically, and everybody should have access to these fruits and so on. It's, you know, you can basically, yeah, they have a internet platform in which you can, from your own position, by walking in the land, you can map these things and put them into common shared map. And so that if you want to make an apple pie, you know exactly where to go and just collect something. Yeah, just by the way, remark.
I don't know, I just, when I was thinking about this connection of the show, which is showing very, I don't know, let's say, individual artistic positions or points of view, but and at the end we are talking about how can we change the world or how we can help or contribute. And I was feeling like there's a big contrast between this kind of solitude of those works, because, or description of what is going on to a soul farmer or peasant, your work is depicting, who has to kind of get rid of that plant, sell it, and find another job, and finally this is all escalating because he's too alone. And I don't know, on the other hand, you have your own world, you live it, which is kind of, let's say, explicit escapism, which is also something. And while you kind of suggest more collective approach to these problems, so that it's like cooperatives, emancipation through, I don't know, discussions and movements such as Via Campesina and etc. So, but I think that there's certain contrast, because I think it's quite difficult to struggle when one is really alone with his problems like this. No.
On the other hand, I think the story with your mother that you mentioned is precisely the one aiming at this. For me, this is one of the ideals of public engagement, that of course you are much stronger if you are in collective, and you can achieve much more. But the question is whether, you know, these kind of on one hand detached, but on the other hand very personalized attitudes can lead maybe to the same goal, basically, I think. And it's because for many people, I think it's problematic to be part of group, to be engaged in specific politics, internal politics, and so on. And I think it's very important to act on our behalf on a daily basis. And the story with your mother, I think, just pictures this very, very nicely.
Yeah, I myself, however, I really sympathize with different cooperatives and groups, and before I was active in activist groups as well, but today I'm much more interested in this small scales and personal things, and to try to avoid institutionalizing. So it's it's more my direction, but I'm not against cooperatives or big movements. Just somehow it's more like that. Before, when I was active in activist groups in a green movement in Budapest, many times I felt that all of our job is totally the same, like fit with this urban lifestyle, mm-hmm. like you organize things and managing things, but there is nothing to really touchable.
Mm.
All is just about theory and convincing others about what they think and so on. And what I'm doing now since about 5-6 years, it's the opposite. I'm doing the thing itself, even if in very small scale, and it's not that effective on others. It's on myself it is effective, and I'm really learning and going deeper on this kind of life. So
yeah, I can fully relate to this, because the more I engaged in whatever communities and so on, at the end of the day, I have stronger and stronger ambition to actually go to the farm and stay there, and just grow it by myself. So maybe if we meet in 5 years, I will be here in the position of a farmer. Who knows?
Yeah. No, I just like this title of your. As you work as an ex-artists collective with your partner Aniko Laurent. So I was just thinking about it, but at the same time, one of your quote is that the aim to survive is connecting us is one of your mottos. I think it's a slogan you use once.
So,
which is actually what I meant probably when I was. Juxtaposing the individual approaches to with and in contrast to this collectiveness of the movements you are usually advocating in your through your texts and supporting them, right? As using them as the new tool of a parallel system to the monopolized system, the mainstream system. Okay. So, I don't know, do we have more questions?
Maybe I think I would like to learn more about the community-based agriculture, because you are saying, I think you seem to be a big supporter of this model of of food production, and since this part is about utopias, like, do you see as something utopical that like that the whole society should work based on this model? Do you think this is possible, or do you think it's a feasible scenario, or under which conditions?
No, I don't think this is the. I don't think community supported agriculture. Should be a general model for society, definitely not. But for me, at the moment, it's probably the most radical thing we have. And from this, many other less radical ones are appearing. And so there's this, CSA for me is a front line of alternatives, and then it's creating different systems which are more keen towards bigger involvement. For example, we are actually discussing this question that you just asked a lot, and we understand that for us it will take ages before the whole society learns about it. We don't have the means, we don't have the structures or anything to promote them even. And we don't even want to like promote them on a national level. I think that's the responsibility of the state. If state wants a healthy society with sustainable agriculture, blah, 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 then the state should be the one who promotes these alternatives at the end of the day. And as part of my last year, we established a platform called Initiative for Food Sovereignty. And I'm the head of the working group for lobbying. And we cooperate closely with several of the political parties which are adopting the ideology or the ethics of food sovereignty, of the ecological agriculture and different models of sharing food. So especially, just to make a little promotion, especially the I think the pirates are really, they have a new, they have bred, and I'm very happy that I could be part of a new political program which is aiming at sustainable agriculture. And I think the pirates agricultural program is one of the most progressive at the moment in Czech Republic. So I think the future is in cooperatives, yes, but on different levels. And one of them, one of the levels we are trying to establish already this year, and that's consumers co-op, consumers cooperative, which will work as a, let's say, I'm hesitant to say the word, but supermarket, in the sense that there will be one place with many importers, let's say 80 importers, all of them organic, but the point is that the subject, the cooperative, will actually resell the food to its members for the same prices that it, that the subject receives. So there is no extra margin.
Yeah, but you have to become a member.
Yes.
Yeah, and do you need to do? Can you become a member without producing?
Yes.
Okay.
So the point is that you, as a
consumer.
As a consumer, have direct access to organic produce mm-hmm. for prices which are non-commercial, mm-hmm. if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. So there is no because the subject will not generate any money. The point of the subject is not to create a profit. Mm-hmm. The point of the subject is to facilitate needs of its members. The needs being access to quality food for affordable prices. Because at the moment, the problem of ecological production and bio production is that, again, it's dominated by several big farmers and also the retailers and the chains through which you can get these produce is very monopolized in many respects. And there's this added value to it translated to a price. So we want to abolish this and get access to the quality food without paying the extra price, which is not necessary. So, and I think through this, much more people can get access to good food, and the farmers can get access to the market, sort of, because that's one of the biggest problems.
Yeah, but if the farmers are not able to make any profit at all from selling their stuff to the cooperative, how are they going to survive?
By subsidies.
No. What he was saying when he mentioned
that.
No.
One very important point with these cooperatives is that the farmers are those who set up the price. It's completely opposite to what the current system is aiming at, when the supermarkets are actually pushing producers and for, you know, you have to we want your product, but we want it for this and that price. If you can't make it, we have another one who is able to provide us. It's not this way, it's completely other way, and this way they can become it's sufficient for them, because they can dictate the prices, of course, with the knowledge, you know, that they're not abusing the system. But this is how it works in the model that we are going to establish is based on the model of cooperative in Dresden, which was established in 1991, and today they have 9,000 members and 5 supermarkets for the members. And
what organization is that?
I can't pronounce the name because it's like it's a German word with 50 letters. But. But anyways, these type of cooperatives are all around the Europe. And you wanted to mention something?
No, just to clarify that when you were saying that the prices are not commercial,
It means that include the fairness, so the yes. farmers are getting a fair price,
yes.
and this is a price that they establish themselves, considering the production cost and the money that they need for living, their working hours, their labor, everything. What it involves that is not a commercial price means that there are not other beneficiaries in the middle. The chain, the commercial chain, is restricted to production consumer. Therefore, all of the pluses are skipped and not adding the price.
It's basically the point is creating partnership, full-scale partnership, and the point is not to find the cheapest production farmer. The point is to create sustainability within the relationship with the farmer, so that we know that there's a farmer who needs our support, and by support I mean that his produce is being that he has the guarantee that the whole year he will be able to sell his produce for sustainable price, and this is what we're aiming at.
And to be able to have a long-term plan, you
yes.
know, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years plan. So when you're planning your economy, you're planning ahead, not like improvising, not knowing what to grow because you don't know how much you're gonna get.
Well, the good thing is that we turned from utopias to already well-established models that are already part
appearing,
of
our appearing models.
Appearing models that are already part of our reality.
Yes, partially.
Since 1990s, you said. Right, but is there another sample like this, like something like that you are very happy with? Something inspiring you in a way, like you would suggest that it be another constructive way?
What's really inspirational for me is that the excluded, meaning peasants, were able to reclaim their position, and that they found out, and I hope that we all will soon find out, that the only way we can move forward as a society is through different types of cooperation and through until we're alone, we have a lot to lose, and that the marginalized actually, and this is a very positive moment for me, that the marginalized are setting up the way. That those who in 18th century through, you know, I mean, capitalism was created through land grabbing in England in 18th century, through fencing and so on, and through getting rid of the peasants. And today, peasants who are being subject to, again, land grabbing and so on, are the ones who are connecting together and creating common solutions. And I think they are the leaders of creating solutions for sustainability in very broad sense. Food is just opening of whole scale models of functioning, because with it there it goes education, health, and everything. So food again is just a tool to promote system change.
Right. We've been talking 2 hours. Wow. Yeah, but I don't know. You know, you can bring more topics because now it's still, I don't know, it's really up to you. You can
maybe Ava mentioned just like an example.
Yes.
Maybe it seems that I come from a peasant country, it's like I come from Sweden. And
it's just something that I want to add to it. It's basically the capital city, Ljubljana, has a very special, like, specificity, which is that it has its own gardens since ever, since like 60, 70 years. And basically, there is no need to emancipate the farmer, or I think the whole country basically is based on farmer agriculture. But it's super specific, the town itself, because the gardens are in a very center. It's not like community gardening or something, but it's
normal peasants. The mm-hmm. normal peasants lived there. So basically also the way the city was expanding, they were not pushed away. They were just like preserved and they were just living and sustaining by their own work. And so, for example, you have this like old town square, and then it's like this small little like a village, farmers' houses, and then there are like apartment flats, like just like growing. But what I want to say is that basically these gardens are sustaining the whole city, meaning that we have the marketplace, which is every day, which for example, which I found in Czech Republic really like maybe trend. It's a trend for the last 5 years, something that is artificially constructed or applied to the society. And basically you see every morning you see the farmers carrying their carriages on their feet to the marketplace. And how is the city helping this or being aware of this phenomenon maybe is as well through through the they actually now in the center banned the traffic, so there's no traffic in a main center. So basically there's also like pollution is actually eliminated or reduced or plus at the same time younger generations are building their own community gardens. So for example, like we are solving maybe problems on the level of like what do we do with the trees, which they need to be cut down. So there is a big activism to basically establish gardens, not gardens, but place or earth for trees to retire. Basically, I really like this idea. Like instead of like to cut down the tree, is like how to pull out the tree and then just put it into a retirement. So this is just something maybe that I would like to mention, that we don't have this kind of activism. We are not mm-hmm. struggling. I mean, I'm sure we are struggling too, but something it's coming really naturally. It's growing like hand by hand. You know, like people who live, they support the farmer because you know I want to eat this food because it's local and so. So I think it's kind of like a good symbiosis.
Yeah, thank you very much for the remark. That's one of the points that we are losing very much, that farms were always connected with the cities, and cities were to big extent sustainable. I'm just doing small research on Žižkov, part of Prague, and the history of city farms in this part of Prague, and to how this developed and changed and disappeared also, and what were the reasons for disappearance. And a very interesting case in France, in which one of the cities, traditionally they had several farms in the city, and the city was to great extent self-sufficient on the local production. And during the 60s, 70s, with the new urban planning, the farms disappeared. Because they got rid of them through because of new buildings, blah, blah, blah. And then in past years, during the very harsh winter, the food trucks couldn't make it to the supermarkets. And of course, you know, supermarkets have storage for around 4 to 5 days worth of food. So they run very quickly out of... We are not aware of this very much, but we depend on 4 days stack of supermarkets loads. So if we run out because of any kind of reason, we're in very big trouble. So of course this happened in this city in France. I can't remember the name, and the society of course were very angry about this, and they decided to re-establish the city farms as a means for some local sustainability and food production, so that society can be, you know, this is actually a very strategic question. I'm very amazed about the attitudes of also the political representation, you know, trying to solve all these problems with subsidies again, but not with self-sufficiency. We used to be self-sufficient in fruits, vegetables, especially, and today we import around from 50 to 90% of all fruits we import, same with vegetables. And just because of lower prices, cheap production costs because of migrant work and so on. So again, I think this is one of the big questions which we should open. We were talking about local activism up until now, but what's incredibly important and very strategical for the whole society is state shift of the agenda. What actually we as a society want to preserve, type, what kind of food production and what kind of food distribution we want to have here. And this is, we all have say in this. We all are part of this scheme, so it's, again, there are different methods how we can push and for this recognition. Yeah.